welcome one and all, and a blessed Thanksgiving to you all. This evening we follow the order of worship that is printed for you in your bulletin, the order of Vespers, which you can also find in the hymnal on page 120. We begin with the confession of sins. Please rise. Dearly beloved, we have come together in the presence of God, our Heavenly Father, to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at His hand, to set forth His most worthy praise, to hear His holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and salvation. Oh, come, let us worship Him. Let us kneel and bow down before Him. Let us confess our sins with penitent hearts and obtain forgiveness by His infinite grace and mercy. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed the devices and desires of our hearts. We have offended against your holy law. We have done those things which we should not have done, and we have not done those things which we should have done. Have mercy on us, O Lord. Spare us and restore us, according to the promises you have declared to us in Jesus Christ our Lord. For His sake, grant that we may live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of your holy name. The Almighty and Merciful Lord has granted us pardon and forgiveness for all our sins, grace for true repentance and amendment of life, and the comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated as we sing the opening hymn.
Lips, and my mouth shall show forth.
reminded that even through the fiery trials of life, that our God is with us and that we can still sing his praises. And so we sing this responsively together. Careful to do, that you may live and multiply, and go in and possess the land that the Lord swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you, and let you hunger, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell these 40 years. Know that in your heart, that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and by fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs flowing out in the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig without fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills you can dig copper, and you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. So far the reading. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Alleluia. Our second lesson from God's word is recorded for us in St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4. St. Paul writes, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Yet it was kind of you to share my trouble. And you Philippians yourselves know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving except you only. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once and again. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit. I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Here ends the reading, and we join together in singing hymn 461. Thank you. a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said to them, Go and show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? And he said to him, Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well. This is the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. O Lord, have mercy upon us.
Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Jesus Christ. Amen. God, the Holy Spirit has caused our text for consideration this evening to be recorded for us in the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 17. And we hear these words again in Jesus' name. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" He said to him, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." So far the text, and we pray. These are your words. Heavenly Father, sanctify us by your truth. Your word is truth. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ who have come giving thanks, this text before us this evening from St. Luke's Gospel is one of those accounts in the Bible where a whole lot could be said about it. I could probably give you 10 sermons on this text and still not feel like I've done the text justice. There's a lot to be gathered from this. We often focus on the Samaritan, the single Samaritan who thanked Jesus. He often gets the spotlight because he serves as an example to us about how we're supposed to give thanks and not forget to say thanks to God and others when they do nice things for us. That's certainly true. The Samaritan does serve as a good example of a believing, thankful person whom we should all emulate in our lives. But tonight, I'd like to focus on Jesus instead. I'd like to examine this text from Jesus' perspective. What was going on in Jesus' mind? What he did and what he said as these 10 lepers came to him for help. And so on this Thanksgiving Eve, we consider as our theme. God helps us even when he knows in advance that we'll forget to thank him like we should. Now, before we consider what Jesus was thinking and doing in this situation with the 10 lepers, we have to first remember who Jesus is. Jesus is not just a human being like you and me. Jesus is also true God, God's Son from all eternity. And as God, Jesus can read people's minds and hearts. And not only that, but he also knows in advance what people are going to do and say. And as these 10 lepers approach Jesus then, asking him to heal them, Jesus already knew that 9 of them were going to go away without thanking him. And yet, healed all 10 of them of their leprosy anyway. And this says something to us about Jesus, about who he is, about who our God is. You see, Jesus didn't have to help these lepers. After all, they were sinners, and Jesus is the holy, perfect God. Doesn't God say to us in his word, in his holy law, "The soul that sins shall die, and the wages of sin is death," and that all people have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God? And could not Jesus, as the holy, perfect Son of God, have denied these sinners their request for help? Especially since he knew that 9 of them weren't going to be thanking him for it anyway. Jesus certainly didn't owe them. Yet Jesus, in his great mercy and love, decided to help them anyway. Jesus, along with his Heavenly Father and the Holy Spirit, are overly loving and merciful to a sinful world that doesn't deserve them. Jesus tells us in Matthew chapter 5, your heavenly Father causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Our God is loving and kind to all people, even to those who do not believe in him. Our God is not like all the false gods and goddesses that people worship. Of all those gods that people have worshipped and still worship to this day, none of them is kind and merciful and unconditionally loving like our God is. All the false religions of the world say, you must do this, you must do that, you must sacrifice this, you must bow down so many times a day and do this and that, and then maybe God will help you out and reward you for your worship. But not so with the Christian God. Not so with the only true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our Heavenly Father knows what we need even before we ask him, says Jesus. And even though he has every right to deny our requests, and would have been justified if he'd done away with this messed up sinful world a long time ago, he has chosen not to. He loves us. He loves this world. And he loves us sinful people. People like you and me, people like the ten lepers. He gives bountifully and freely to all, not expecting anything in return. God makes sure that the atheist who doesn't even acknowledge his existence has a roof over his head and a nice warm bed to sleep in. To the woman who completely disregards God's commandments and will for her life, God still gives to her a loving family and surrounds her with love. To the man who never ever thinks about God, God will still give a steaming turkey and pile of mashed potatoes on his plate this Thanksgiving day. To the nine lepers who would not say thank you, Jesus, God's Son, still healed them anyway. God is good to all indiscriminately. And he gives all of us a time of grace in this world because he wants all people to see and acknowledge his goodness. He wants all people to repent of their sins and to believe in Jesus so that they might be saved. God wants all people to come to the knowledge of the truth in Jesus. And so he's patient and loving and gives so many good things to us, his sinful creatures, more than we could ever ask or deserve. Jesus healed these 10 lepers because his great love compelled him to do so. He didn't have to. He wanted to. Because he loved them with true love. A love that expected nothing in return. Notice how Jesus discreetly healed these lepers as they went on their way. Jesus didn't really make a big show of it, did he? If you had the power to miraculously heal people, wouldn't you make a big show of it? Well, I would. But not Jesus. God's Son. God does his work quietly and humbly. He's God. He doesn't have anything to prove. He doesn't need our applause and approval. He just does it because he loves with an incomparable, selfless love. Truly a lesson for us proud sinners who too often think we're all that and have to tout our accomplishments to others. Jesus, God's Son, came to this earth, humbled himself. He was born in the manger, and he died a humiliating death on the cross to save us. It was unimpressive, and yet it was the greatest act that ever happened in human history. On the cross, Jesus paid for our sins and for the sins of the whole world. Let that sink in further. Jesus paid even for the sins of those who refused to believe in him. What love divine. Jesus' atoning death on the cross means that we are forgiven for the times when we've failed to truly be thankful to God for all the blessings that he's given to us. Forgiven for the times when we've been ungrateful to each other, too. Jesus has taken away our sins and given us new life by his Holy Spirit. And the same Spirit who works faith in us through the Word and through the sacraments, He changes our cold and selfless hearts so that we learn to be truly thankful and rejoice in all circumstances of life. When we, by the Spirit, in faith, humbly realize and acknowledge that we're not really deserving of anything, and yet God has still given us so much, we become truly thankful from the heart. There will be people this year, in the year 2020, who shrug and say, what in the world do we have to be thankful for this year? A pandemic, job losses left and right, poverty on the rise, closed restaurants and entertainment venues, a broken, divided political system that never seems to get anything right, can't see our family at Thanksgiving this year, uncertainty in our world. What do we have to be thankful for? They will say. But as Christians, we see God's goodness and mercy to us still. We see it all around us. In spite of not having everything we want all the time, we rejoice because our Heavenly Father still provides for all of our needs. And if any of you is in need, we as your family in the Christian Church are here to help you. Please don't hesitate to ask for help. And if any of us is lacking anything, we can pray to our God, who has promised to help us and to answer our prayers according to his will. And above all, as Christians, we see the cross, God's gift of salvation and eternal life to us, the gift that we don't deserve, and we rejoice to know that it's all ours, no matter what happens, by God's grace. And so with hearts of faith, we can say, we have a lot to be thankful. A lot indeed. We have eternal life through Jesus. This Thanksgiving, let us count our blessings. Let us rejoice with grateful hearts and sing to the Lord of the harvest, who still gives us many, many good things. Let us stomp down the devil, who wants us this Thanksgiving to focus only on the negative, to be ungrateful, to be grumbly and depressed and uncharitable and greedy and resentful and focused only on ourselves and all of our problems. Let us instead rejoice and laugh in his face and say, how good our God has been to us. Let us, like the Samaritan leper whom Jesus healed, bow before Jesus our Savior and praise him. My Christian friends, to you I say, happy Thanksgiving. It is happy indeed through faith in Jesus. Let us rise and go our way, for our faith has made us well. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, forevermore. Sing the
Let my prayers rise before you as incense.
The communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
good evening.
Good evening.
And happy Thanksgiving to all of you. I guess there's no like real response for that, you know, that's kind of right. And also with you, I do hope you all have a good Thanksgiving. I know it might be a little bit of a different Thanksgiving this year, but we still rejoice in our God, and even if we can't be with all of our family this year, we're reminded that God is with us. He's with us at that table, He's with us in our homes and in our living room, and as we lie down to go to bed at night, He is with us to care for us, to watch over us, and to always provide for all of our needs. And for that, we really do say thank you to our God who is with us. So, happy Thanksgiving to all of you, and hope to see you all on Sunday. Thanks.